Are you all filled?
Amen.
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 The other day I had everything, Brother Given, that I was ready, my outline for this discussion.
Well, I'm glad to be here. I love you. What appointment means to me is that Jesus appointed life. Simply put, he appointed life. We had a young man take his life a few weeks ago, and I worked right beside him. God didn't appoint that for him. He appointed life for that man.
Amen.
And I can say I wish I would have known what that guy was going through, because someone like me could have told him that the Lord's appointed life for you, not death. He says somewhere in Revelation, I believe, that for someone who doesn't accept Jesus Christ as Lord, his name will be blotted out of the book of life. Mm-hmm. Well, for a name to be blotted out means it once had to be written there. So he's appointed life to everyone by this blood of Jesus Christ, by what he did. So he's appointed life, and I'm very grateful. The more I sense it, more just that four-letter word, how big it is, appointed that life.
Amen.
Isn't that more abundantly?
Amen. Amen. Amen.
God knew me long before I knew him.
Amen.
I don't for a moment think that David was the only one he knew in his mother's womb before he was born. Adam knew Eve, and they had an intimate relationship. God loved me fully and unconditionally. When I accepted him and finally knew him, my love began to grow. You ask my wife, and she says, my life seems to go like this, like a level plane. It's not true. It goes up and down. I get disappointed. I'm up and down. And the reason for that is because I lose my perspective.
Yeah, that's right.
I don't know how many times on Monday morning, Brother Seth, I wanted to write my letter. Say, how can you preach two sermons a week and people just sit there and sit there? But the Holy Spirit comes to me and says, fix your eyes on Jesus. You know what that means? I hate to admit that I watch television occasionally, but that stupid commercial where the worker is attached to a girder by his hat, you know, and it says, you just drop one little spot of this chemical and you're attached hard hat to I-beam. Well, that's the word, super glue. Super glue your eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of your faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and now seated at the right hand of God on high. Consider him who endured the things from shameful men so that you don't lose heart. So when life's going like this, remember your appointment. But God knew you a long time before you knew him. And I've concluded that there are a lot of things that I could do, dozens, maybe 100 things, if I put my mind to it. But there's only one thing I can do because I put my heart to it, and that's to serve him for the rest of my life. This man has taught me so much more than I could ever teach another person. That's one thing that he's always encouraged me with, is that you have one purpose in life, and that's to serve the Lord Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Thanks.
Amen.
For your saying.
Amen. Amen.
Heard Bob and Jason and Maybell and some others talking about equipment this morning, microphones and tape decks, etc. He may have patched some of this in, but if you go outside the Empire District, you have to tear something up to break those connections. Now, we're hardwired, rock solid. And as she said, we have access to God anytime. He knows our needs constantly, our state of mind. We sometimes go to him, I think, as though we expected to pay international long-distance rates. Should not be so. We should not neglect his access to that salvation.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
What he just said, that reminded, this is what I'm going to talk about, but I had about a three-year-old grandson that had a little playpen, and he was punching numbers. It was taking him a good while. And I said, son, who are you calling? He says, God. He said, you know, he's far away. I said, oh, son, we got some things to talk about. He's 8, and he knows a whole lot better than that now. God's real close to him. I wanted to share one thing. the more I learn about things being imputed to me, the more precious it is. Mm. You know, it was quite revelation to me to know that just justice of God had been placated and justification imputed to me. Now, strangely enough, you know, as you began to preach it, you're preaching it to those that haven't accepted it, and so they accuse you of being lawless and, you know, condoning anything. And that's when you knew you was on the right track, because that you might, at least, you didn't know whether he's there or not, but it began to make sense that they may be accusing you of the same thing they were accusing Paul of. But now, what was interesting in my personal life is I began to get along much better with everyone. I began to especially get along with my wife much better, and she began to consider me a much better Christian. So the more that I understood about justification being imputed to me, but then when sanctification began to dawn upon me and the sanctification being imputed, that was again, when I preached it, people said, well, you believe in anything, don't you? it must be getting close to the truth here because, you know. But others that wasn't hearing the message but just seeing me began to be, Brother Leon, your life has just changed over the last several years. You're much more calmer and meeker and more humility, and you're just much easier to get along with. And y'all can ask my wife. Here I am right in front of her and with no gun pointed to her. The more you can accept what is imputed to you, the more you can experience it personally.
Amen.
You know, I'm glad that God and Jesus Christ was in the beginning of time. Mm-hmm. And at the right time, God appointed his son, yes, to man.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
No, I definitely will back it up for him. It's really, our marriage is in much better shape, much better. Of course, and in our studies, there was something I finally began to dawn on me, first, that Christ Jesus was appointed as my substitute on the cross. Amen. Because he was both the Son of Man and the Son of God. Mm-hmm. Now, for years, I had always accepted Christ as deity, and I really felt contemptuous for people that would deny the deity of Christ. That was just beyond my understanding. But at the same time, I could not realize that Christ was fully human. Mm-hmm. He was always at a distance and not really one of us. Mm-hmm. And once I began to realize that he was fully human, his full humanity, it has, you know, the dualness of his personality, the realness of the sacrifice then completely overwhelmed me.
Mm-hmm.
And then to getting back to the justification, to realize the justification, and especially our imputed sanctification. This has been a real special study for us, and one that has come to mean a lot. And I feel like now, with realizing Christ's real nature, I will be more able to appropriate the blood in daily sanctification.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
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 I just knew that there'd be some of you who'd want to talk about that word appointment. Oh, well, come right on up here. I apologize. I'll wait. If anybody else wants to speak after her, jump right up, run.
Well, I thank the Lord for the precious blood of Christ.
Amen.
which he shed for us. And we were made for God's fellowship. But we needed Jesus to shed his blood for us, or we would have never been able to be his fellowship. And all we have done since our salvation has been because of Christ's blood.
Amen.
And the way we've raised our families and everything that we have done has been to prepare us and our loved ones for the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the Lord wanted in the beginning. It's opened our eyes up and our ears up. I'm talking about our eternal person, mm-hmm. our spiritual person, to understanding we would have never known if he hadn't opened our eyes. And I thank you for that.
Amen.
And there's eternal hope for all now.
Yes.
We have many brethren.
Mm-hmm.
I thank the Lord for that. We're a large family to be forever throughout eternity with God.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what we're doing is we're looking for a new heaven and a new earth wherein mm-hmm. dwelleth righteousness.
Amen.
With the Father and the Son and all the angels. And we look forward to seeing his face, having perfect fellowship with him. And while we're waiting here, we're preparing ourselves for that,
mm-hmm.
learning of his word and accomplishing new accomplishments for Christ.
Amen.
And now, one of these days, we will be his perfect fellowship. And I thank the Lord for that.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Isn't it great how, as the years go by, God opens your eyes a little wider?
Yeah,
a little more.
Yes.
Brother Wilson in the eighth decade, I'm in the seventh decade. Praise God. He has brought us this far, and each time we get together, we learn something. God has impressed on me, I'm talking about appointment, that at the time of the Lord's Supper, the communion time, which we are accused of lots of times in our churches as being a ritual,
mm-hmm.
Needs to be much more meaningful. And it came to me, I didn't have any wild background to be converted out of. I was born in a Christian home. Remember, grandfather who sang in the choir and with his big bass voice, and praise God for him. And my mother. Anyway, it has dawned on me at the appointment of the time for communion, it's a very important time. All points with God are now.
Yes.
We can go back to the foot of the cross at communion time. It's as if we could just have a time machine that we could, in our heart, in our mind, it's the one thing that is physical. God didn't send a photo album down of what Jesus looked like or a lot of different things. He did give us the Word of God, but this is one thing that's partially physical where we can go back actually to touch the body and the blood of Jesus at Calvary's cross. In my mind, as I sit there meditating on the Word of God, I think back, somebody, I mentioned my mother and my grandfather, but before them, people I didn't know, my ancestry, somebody passed the Word on down, generation after generation. So it is as if you can go back to the 1800s, and the 1700s, and the 1600s as you're preparing your heart to take communion, and the 1500s, and in our particular family, I have the testimony of my parents that in the 1500s, we had a martyred a martyred ancestor who was martyred, burned at the stake, Hugh Latimer, in England for his faith. And I guess this man Ridley was with him at that time, if you read back on it. He's in the direct ancestor. Praise God, in my mind I go back and there he is. But I go on back to that 14, 13, go back through the centuries, and somebody has been faithful with the Word of God all the way through. Mm-hmm. And the blood of God and the body of Jesus, the blood and the body were effective then. Mm-hmm. And all the way back to the very foot of the cross, and there's Jesus willingly giving his blood and allowing his body to be martyred there for me. Because he said, he didn't say, now this emblem is my body. He said, this is my body. Yeah. And this blood he poured out is my body. He didn't say this wine or this cup or whatever, but this is my blood, I mean. So the blood which covers our sins, the appointment we keep with that, and the body of Christ, in effect in my mind and my heart, I can go back and touch the hem of the garment, as it were, and touch the very body and the blood, and come back. By the time we get done with all that, they're taking the offering. But anyway, you just let your, since we are spiritual as well as physical, you let your spirit part just go back at the appointment time of the communion, and then do this in remembrance of me, he said. Praise God. We ought to be shouting for joy. You know, Brother Hutch and I was thinking, this radio station's changed hands, evidently, across the street. It's one of the older radio stations in town, WMBH, I think it was. Somewhere it's going to be sold again. Maybe this congregation ought to buy it and pray, sing the praises of the Lord and put that out on there. God gives us opportunities from time to time, but the greatest thing, I think, is appointment that we can keep right now is to come to the Lord at the time of the Lord's Supper and visualize him and be with him in that moment of remembrance, and then burst forth in joy because he has saved my soul.
Yes.
He's bringing the family together all around the world. We need to buy up the time. Praise God.
Amen. Okay. The world has a problem. Those who are not in Christ have a problem. Now, the Lord has a wondrous situation. But the predicament is explaining the wondrous thing that God has to a world that can't even understand the predicament there is. Mm-hmm. When I was a young man growing up, there were a lot of people who I am certain loved the Lord and who spoke a lot concerning the Scripture, but I never understood a thing they were talking about. And I am certain that a lot of the key words regarding redemption were said to me, and I should have understood, but I just didn't. But I understand something now. I understand that in order for a man to come to Christ, he's got to not only understand his need, but understand the provision that God has given.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
God, in regard to this word appointed, has appointed the shedding of blood as the only means for forgiveness of sin. Mm-hmm. Now that's any sin of anyone at any time.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow, the man outside of Christ, the woman outside of Christ, the young person outside of Christ, has got to understand that. There are a few passages of Scripture which come to my mind. In fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life. But only the high priest entered the inner room, and that only once a year, and never without blood, which he offered for himself and for the sins the people had committed in ignorance.
The world needs to know this. Quite honestly, on July 25th, 1969, when Roy Weiss baptized me into Christ, I had a little bit of an understanding, Brother David, about redemption, because we had pop bottles at that time, which you could take in and get a nickel for, 3 cents at that time. I had about that much understanding of it. I didn't have any understanding of the word propitiation. It was Brother P.T. Butler who taught me more excellently in that manner. I didn't have any understanding of the word sanctification. It was Brother Gerald Zook who taught me regarding that at another time. I had very little understanding of the word justification except what Roy Weiss would teach me in the few years that he would be left. But these things happen in this conversion process, Brother Dave. Mm-hmm. In this time, this fleeting moment, I mean, it went quick now, but it was all there. But there was no way I could take it all in. But I know that God has appointed that shedding of blood is the only means for the forgiveness of sin. I know that God has appointed that time for me to come into Christ. But at that moment, I didn't have the time, quote, quote, to examine it all. But now we do. And now we can look at it, and now we can pick it up, and now we can embrace it, and now we can glory in it, now we Amen. Can utilize it, because there is a man who is now glorified.
Amen.
He's now God. Amen. There is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all men, the testimony given at his proper time. This man is doing things for you and I right now. Mm-hmm. And he has been ever since you came into him, and he will forever. Mm-hmm. And what he is doing involves propitiation, involves justification, involves sanctification, involves redemption, and it just goes on and on and on. Constantly at the Father's side, he sits. And ask you this question regarding some of these words which men have so excellently expounded upon, regarding the shedding of blood, his forgiveness of sin, regarding then the propitiation, the justification, the sanctification. What now does that mean to you? What does it mean to you? Now you have a chance to handle it. Now you have a chance to expound it. And I know you want to talk about it, don't you? Mm-hmm. I knew you did, Brother Dave, in saying yes. All right. Take a moment and expound to us what these great things now mean to you.
As these things have been expounded, it has actually increased my confidence. Not self-confidence. I have never have been a self-confident person. A lot of people who know me find that difficult to believe. They figure that I'm sort of a brash person, bold person, but I'm really not. If I talk about anything but Christ and salvation, it's very, very difficult for me. My confidence is in God. And there are times when I have absolutely no confidence at all in my own ability or in someone else's ability to appreciate my dilemma, but absolute confidence in God to come to Him. Now, it's mind-boggling to a lot of people. We have experienced in some of the trials we've passed through in our life, people, they say, well, we don't know how you go through that. And they sort of figure you're going to fail. They don't understand what confidence in God is, but now I do, and I thank God I can recommend it to everybody, that you may be a lot of things you don't know and a lot of things you don't have confidence in, but when you hear the truth affirmed about what God has done, affirmed and declared, it will actually gender confidence in you, and you'll be able to go to God when it looks like it's impossible that you'll get there. You will go anyway.
Amen. Amen.
I've been waiting to read this passage, and this fits all of these things together that Brother Bill just mentioned from Ephesians 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. This also includes appointments, several appointments, by the way. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be, another appointment, holy and blameless before him. In love he predestined us, another appointment, to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, another appointment along with all these other things, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, more appointments, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, more appointments, which in all wisdom and insight he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his kind intention, which he proposed in him, more appointments, with a view to the administration suitable to the fullness of all of the times, that is the summing up of all things in Christ, things in the heavens and things upon the earth. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, all of these things that he has done and he has granted us in his Son, an inheritance having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will, to the end that we who were the first to hope in Christ should be the praise of his glory. And in him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given as a pledge of our inheritance, with a view to the redemption of God's own possession, to the praise of his glory. Not really. Puts all of those things together. Multitude of things, wonderful, precious things.
I don't like to come up here, but I feel so compelled. Something our brother said last night, Brother Given, said it in the words that I have been searching lately. I gotten a hold of a book of Watchman Nee's called The Salvation of the Soul. And what the Lord has been speaking to me is that when we turn to anything else for comfort, but to him, then we're saying that Jesus' death was not enough.
Yeah. Right.
And what we do time and time again is we're in that holy place and we continue to lay the sacrifice on the altar and we continue to wash ourselves and we're saying, I'm still not good enough, I'm still not ready to enter into the Holy of Holies. And it's a lack of faith. And what we're
Amen.
Saying is, Jesus,
Amen.
You did not do enough for me, and I have to keep trying and I have to keep working
Amen.
And I have to keep striving.
Amen.
And we don't.
Amen.
And as
Amen.
You said, brother, to reach that fullness and appropriate everything that the Lord has for us, we must press on into the Holy of Holies.
Yes.
Amen.
We must appropriate the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
We must, because if we don't, what are we saying to the world? And what are we saying to each other? We're saying, Jesus, you didn't do enough.
Mm-hmm.
You did not do enough.
Yes. Very good.
I think this is just a little personal testimony for my wife and myself. Some of you are bound to think it's strange that she and I was actually reared in a background in which the deity of Christ was not very affirmed. As a matter of fact, it was nearly denied. And therefore, literally, she and I come from that background of which we really had to learn about the deity of Christ. And we so embraced that. That was very, very liberating. That we had, as the pendulum swings, you began to forget about his humanity. And of course then that's what she was picking up on, is we kind of overlooked that. But he that sanctified is the same as those whom he sanctified.
Yeah.
That means he sanctified humans, and therefore he was a human. But we also know to be a suitable substitute, he had to be both God and man. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I don't know of anybody else that could serve as a substitute. And I don't know how in the world any other one but who has God as a father and woman as a mother, it seems to me the virgin birth has to be. And the stupidity would be in thinking it's otherwise, not in thinking that it was. So it's the other side that's fooled on that. So we had to have, and of course then, the most important thing anyone could ever say about Christ is he is our substitute.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen. The overall effect that this renewal has had on my own spirit has been somewhat of a challenge to dig in deeper into the things of God. And each one of you brothers and sisters that have spoken have ministered to that end, and I thank you for that. But it's been a wonderful thing to see. It's like when we get together, we actually have this ministry one to another to dig in deeper, and that's good.
Amen.
And I would like to say on this matter that Brother Leon and his wife have been talking about, you know, that a lot of this misunderstanding about the Godhead is brought into play by the use of man's terminology, like deity is not actually a Bible word. And I wrestled with this myself, too. I can remember when this was kind of a problem area for me. But when you think about it, this is answered, is clarified just in the confession of faith that we've been called upon to confess when we came into Christ. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. See, there you have, he's holy God, he's holy man. See, and these two things are brought together in the confession, see, and if we stick to the language of Scripture, see, then we're on safe grounds and it doesn't make for confusion.
Amen.
Amen.
I am so thankful to my understanding of God that when he redeemed me through Jesus, Jesus literally provided a covering between God and me so that I might not be a child of wrath, that he made me legally right in God's eyes, and that he set me apart for holy service.
Amen.
Therefore, those words, propitiation, justification, and sanctification, have become very dear to me. I don't know how much longer, if you want to continue, it feels like getting this warm, getting warm to me, but there is a thought I want to share. And if you want to continue talking, I'll be glad, but this would be the final thing that I want to share with you today. And I say this in respect to Brother Strauss, and I'm not going to give you a boring sermon on how physical blood is a symbol of Christ. I heard him say that the other night, and that would be quite boring if you had to endure that for a long time. But there is a thought there to me that is worthy saying, and that is that blood as we know it is the only medium that can transport the substances that we need in life.
Mm-hmm.
Without blood, we're dead, mm-hmm. physically speaking. Mm-hmm. Blood is made up of many different components, we know that. We're not going to have a high school biology lesson. But we do understand it is responsible for carrying the oxygen to and from the lung. It allows you to breathe. We do understand that it feeds your organs with glucose, which is a pure type of food that the body has produced, that God has been able to make your body produce. That it is responsible also for removing the waste material from your body, and most people don't realize that. that it is responsible for fighting off diseases and that it regulates body temperature. And all of these things, and probably much more, you can parallel to what Christ does in your life.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
The blood in the body has a variety of purposes, and even though William Harvey established it in written form a long time ago, even the primitive pagan lifestyles of man far before him realized the significance of blood. There was fear involved with it. There was victory involved in it. And there was companionship involved in it. I want you to know that blood was not an object that God chose after the fact because man had developed a solemnness towards it.
Mm-hmm.
Blood was part of creation.
Mm-hmm.
God made it like it is for a purpose, that our minds would be sensitive towards it.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
You remember what the first thing said regarding about it was? Your brother's blood cries out to me. Mm-hmm. It had meaning mm-hmm. to Cain. We can't help but see in creation God made blood the integral part of physical, mental, social, and even spiritual, that those makeups of his body, of his soul. And your blood, the blood of your flesh, buys you time. Every time a cell of that blood carries oxygen to one of your organs, you are granted one more heartbeat.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Just one more. The blood is made up of many things. Christ's blood, though, is not made up of red and white cells. It's not made up of platelets. It's not made up of plasma. But figuratively, in there, we see redemption, propitiation, sanctification.
Mm-hmm.
Justification.
Mm-hmm.
The big difference is, while blood buys you one more heartbeat, Christ's blood buys you eternity.
Amen.
Amen.
We know that we were not redeemed with perishable things. We were redeemed, what? The precious blood of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
These passages of Scripture I'm going to leave with you. Again, if you want to continue to talk through, but I'll finish my part. Regarding blood, regarding our thoughts of it, God, what he has put in our mind. Remember, Jesus is saying, I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he'll bear much fruit, but apart from me, you can do nothing.
Mm-hmm.
That's how important the blood of Christ is to you.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. That's how important it is. Mm-hmm. But we look back above this, we see that when they hurled insults at him, Jesus, he did not retaliate.
Mm-hmm.
When he suffered, he made no threats.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly, and he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. That's what the blood signifies. Jesus, talking to a grieving sister, said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
Mm-hmm.
Do you believe this?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen
to that.
Amen.
Amen, brothers and sisters. Do you have any more to say?
Amen.
Please do. If not, Brother Gibbon will come to you.
We thank you for your contributions in this session. Some of these sessions, for some wax a little long, and we really don't mean to wear people out, but better to be worn out for Jesus than for someone else.
Amen.
And the flesh has caused us a lot of trouble, so fair enough. Let it suffer a little bit. We trust that. Just to beat it into subjection. That's right. We're going to dismiss now. We're going to have a meal at 5:30, and then we're serving.